Praise God. Have a couple announcements as we get started here. Variety is this week. If you're going to Variety, that is down in Rollins. You should definitely go if you are able to go. It will start on Wednesday, so there is no Wednesday night service here, but certainly if you want to travel down to Rollins for Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, we will help you find a hotel. Please see one of us or Sister Carnahan or, no, not Sister Carnahan, but somebody, and we will help you find hotels and that sort of stuff. This week is the plant sale fundraiser, so if you need any plants, you know anybody that needs plants, please send them to the church because it is a fundraiser for the church. Pickups are needed to transport plants. What day? Don't know yet. Sister C will text everybody. And helpers will be needed to transport and set up the plants at the church. So if you would like to participate in any of that, certainly feel free. As far as tonight, we have some amazing things going on. Brother Carlos is going to get baptized in the name of Jesus. That is absolutely awesome. All of his sins are going to be completely washed away tonight in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Oh, that's something to rejoice in. Yes.
That is just so awesome. And tonight there is an immense amount of faith that I feel in this place, straight from the prayer room into the sanctuary tonight. And I am believing that God is going to do some absolutely phenomenal things. Carlos, I'm believing that God is going to fill you with the Holy Ghost tonight, stronger than he ever has before, in Jesus' name. I believe that is here for every single person that has never received the gift of the Holy Ghost. You can receive it in this place tonight, in Jesus' name. I'm believing if you need a healing tonight, our God is in this place to heal you tonight. If you need deliverance tonight, our God is in this place to deliver you tonight. So from the start, we are going to pray that God would open up our hearts and our minds, open us up to whatever he is going to do. So any perception that we have brought before us, we are just going to lay that down and say, God, I just want all of you. I want everything about you in my life tonight. So if there is somebody next to you and it's appropriate, lay your hands on them. And we're going to pray for one another right from the start that God would open us up to what he is going to do tonight. Jesus, I thank you so much, God, for allowing us to come into your presence, God. Lord, I pray absolutely for every person under the sound of my voice in this building, God, that our hearts and minds would be open and exposed unto you, God, that we would be exposed unto your presence, God, and who you are, Lord, that however, whatever you want to do tonight, Jesus, that we would allow you to flow freely in this place, God, uninhibited, Jesus, into every single life, God, into every heart and into every mind, God. I pray for those healings right now, Jesus, Lord, that you would begin to heal, God, that you would begin to deliver, God, and that the Holy Ghost would flow freely inside of this place, God, that through the power and the faith that you have spoken in your word, God, it is here tonight upon every person, God, and I am believing that in your strength. In Jesus' name, we pray these things tonight. If you believe that, let's clap our hands unto God as Sister Jennifer comes to sing tonight.
Give us altar like no other, your name. Let the nations sing it louder, nothing has the power to say but your name. Shelter like no other, your name. Let the nations sing it louder. Nothing has the power to say but your name.
Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Jesus.
Everybody ought to know. Everybody ought to know.
Amazing.
friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God, and He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend.
Thank you.
Hallelujah, Jesus. We exalt your name, God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. I love those last few songs just because I think it's so important to not say, God, I'm praising you because of what you have done or what you're going to do. But God, I just praise you for who you are. I thank you, God, for coming down here on this earth and living as a man just as we were. I'm thankful that our God is so merciful and graceful, unlike these other gods. He's not so high above that we can't reach out to him, but ultimately he is truly a friend. He is a best friend to us, where we can turn to him and say, hey, I need some help, God. I need some help in this area. I need some deliverance. Whatever it may be, our God is ultimately that God there. And we can praise him just for being that God without any of those things attached, without those strings attached, but just because he is that great and mighty God. So let's just lift up our hands and let's just praise him for being such a mighty God, for being so worthy just for a few seconds here. Let's just, everybody across this place, let's just clap our hands and glorify him, because Jesus, you are so worthy, God. You are so mighty, God. Lord, I thank you so much, Jesus, for who you are, God. I thank you, Lord, for your presence, Lord. I thank you, God, for coming in this place, Jesus. Lord, we glorify your name, God, and we magnify you for who you are, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise your mighty name, God. Praise your mighty name, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Because what a great God he is, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. If you want to be seated tonight, you can be, in Jesus' name. I'm going to open up this time for four testimonies to give glory to that God and who he is, in Jesus' name. So praise God. We have one here. Do we have three more testimonies that we'd like to give? Praise God. We'll start with Brother Rick, and then we will continue from there.
As some of you guys might know, we took a trip to Michigan to see my mom, and there's a little Pentecostal church there about 15 miles from my mom's, and we went there, and they remembered who we were, and they asked us to do a song, and Jenny chose Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. We got up there to sing, and we noticed there was a harmonica player behind us, and just doing a beautiful job. And when we were done, the pastor there let everybody know that that was no coincidence, because we just picked a song out of a book, and that gentleman wanted to play the harmonica and didn't want to be alone, so he got up and did with us. And the song that he wanted to do was not just Amazing Grace, but Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. It was a complete. And we had other people would call coincidences, but they happened too often. Even the Bible verses that Jen and I would talk about going on road trips while we were there ended up being the subject of, you know. And it's what I really want to say, though, is that it is so phenomenal to know that the very same God that is right here in this church tonight is the exact same God that they worship over in Michigan. No difference. Everything is exactly the same. He's the same God. Praise Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Somebody else, praise God, has a testimony of God. Praise the Lord. Yes, amen.
Well, last week I wasn't at service, and I was in Casper with my son. On Friday, he went to work. He's 18 years old, mind you, strong fella. and he works his little booty off. He works all the time. He works at the city or at the county, and he also works at Applebee's. And so he's a strong, you know, good kid. And he called me from work, or texted me, which I still can't believe he texted me, but he texted me from work and said, I'm not feeling right. I don't know what's going on. I can't walk from here to the Gator, and I'm really lightheaded, and I actually had some blood in my urine last night, so I don't know what's going on. So I said, okay, Mike's coming. He's going to take you to the hospital. Mike called his boss, said you need to go out there, make sure that he's okay. We took him to the hospital, and we just thought, oh, dehydration or something like that. It wasn't. It was something completely out of the ordinary, and they had to do a blood transfusion. Because he was 18, he was able to withstand, but he had been losing blood for a while, and he was down to basically half of what your body is supposed to hold. And so he did get a blood transfusion, and they did a bunch of tests in Gillette, and they couldn't find anything. And so they decided that they needed to take him to Casper. So they took him to Casper in the ambulance, and I was scared. I'm a mom, and so I sent out the prayer request, and everyone started praying for him, and things, you know, started to look up. But then on Sunday morning, his blood levels went back down to a 7.5, and they're supposed to be anywhere from a 10 to a 12. With an 18-year-old, it should be 12. And they had gone up a little bit after the blood transfusion, but they went back down Sunday morning. Mike came to church, and you all prayed for him. And because of what God does with your prayers and how amazing he is, his blood levels went up to a 9.4 that few hours after church. They never went back down again. They did. Yeah, God is good. He's awesome.
Oh, he is awesome.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus. Praise you, God. Yeah. Another cool part of this is that they did test after test after test. You know, he's 18. This shouldn't be happening. And Sunday night, I was praying, and I was like, you know, his levels went up. Yay, that's good. But I hadn't really got the revelation yet. And so I was praying. I was like, God, we're spending so much money here and so much time. You know, I miss service. I want to go home. My kid wants to go home. He wants to eat. He can't eat anything, you know. And what God said to me was, Chrissy, they can do every test they want, but they're not going to find anything. You prayed for healing. Your church prayed for healing. I healed him. They're not going to find out why he bled. And that came to pass. And I was able to tell, you know, by that faith that he gave me and that hope that he gave me, I was able to testify to each one of those doctors. Every time they came in to take more blood, I'm like, you're not going to find anything. God told me he healed him. He's healed. And, you know, for a little while, they were like, oh, yeah, you know. But then they, you know, by the end of it, by the last day when they were getting ready to do the last test, the doctor came in and said, we give up. We're done. We're not going to do this last test. We're going to let you guys go because I believe what you said. You know, this was a freak thing. Whatever happened is gone now. And I'm like, so, yeah, God healed him, right? He wouldn't agree with me, but, yeah, God's good. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah. That's awesome.
Yes, amen.
That's awesome.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Yes, amen. Thank you, Jesus.
And we got a little living testimony here. I praise God for our son. I could go into probably telling you everything, but I want to say that serving God is an awesome thing. And he has opened up so many doors for this child to come into our lives that I can only give him the glory for that. Without him, this would not have happened. And I serve the true God, and I love him with all my heart. And I just lift this child up to him because he's going to serve our Lord. And I just thank you, church here, every one of you, for your prayers through all this journey that's been going on for over 2 years. But I just thank him, our Lord, for this. Praise Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
God is great and greatly to be praised all the time. As I live longer for the Lord, I realize that storms are not just, or you know, God is not going to keep us from storms. He wants us to go through it, because if we don't go through it, we're never going to grow. If you take Peter, for example, he watched Jesus walk out on the water, and they were in the midst of a storm, and he asked Jesus, or he said, Peter told Jesus, Lord, if that's you, bid me to come out on the water. And Jesus said, come. And when Peter walked out on the water, this is impossible for a person to walk on the water, but Peter was able to walk on the water. And he kept his eyes on Jesus in the midst of the storm, but all of a sudden, the storms of life was bothering him, and he took his eyes off of Jesus. And when he did that, we started sinking. So when we go through storms of life, a lot of you people know what the storms we were going through, and it seemed like it was going on, but through the entire time I wasn't worried, because I know that God has us under control. And when Peter took his eyes off, he started sinking, and Jesus reached out his hand and picked him back up. And I know that God will pick us back up, even though sometimes we look at the storm and we think, well, the storm is too big, I cannot handle this, because we forget about who we serve, and we start focusing on the storm when we need to focus on Jesus. But I thank the Lord for everything he's done and everything he will do, in Jesus' name.
God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. I am so thankful for this wide array of testimonies. The Bible says that Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, meaning he's the A through the Z. So everything in between, everything on both ends, Jesus covers all that. And I'm thankful that he does that for all of us in here as well. So let's clap our hands one more time unto Jesus as Pastor Carnahan comes, in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. Clap your hands, all ye people. All ye people. Jesus' name. You can be seated. Praise God. A couple of commercials I got to take out and get out of the way here. I know you. Yeah, so good to see you. I'm so glad that you're here tonight. So glad that you're here. You know, I got this all figured out. I finally figured it out. I needed a mom like her. I really did. I think my mom graduated from Fort Myers or something like that. She would have said, be hard on that kid. Work him twice as hard, you know, and all that kind of business. But her, my goodness, she's that's cool. That is so cool. Praise God. I needed a mom like that, and I got one. Praise God. Yeah, we're kind of together and that type of thing. So it's cool. Praise God. Just wanted to take care of that. So glad that you folks are here tonight. It is a good place to be. Praise God. I'm trusting that the revelation of God's word is going to be just tremendous. Praise God. And we understand that there's a historical word. You know, you can read the Bible. A lot of people do, and that's a good thing. And a lot of things can happen just by doing that. But we also know that there's a process called God revealing himself. And that's been happening in this place, by the way. Praise God. And it's tremendous. It's tremendous when you begin to see the Lord for who he is, what he really wants to do, in Jesus' name, because there are a tremendous amount of needs here tonight. I can sense that. You've come here tonight, and God is the one that can meet those needs. I'm just sowing seeds right now is what I'm doing. If you've got something wrong, physically wrong with you tonight, you're in the right place. God's a healer. And that's not me. Don't look at me. Don't look at this church. You've come to a place where people have gathered together and lifted him up. And when that happens, praise God, faith begins to move. And the scripture teaches us that one of the basic doctrines of Christ is having faith towards God. That's what you got to do if you want to get anything from him. And what does the scripture say? You know, without faith, it's impossible to please him. He that cometh to God, what? First must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Now, I'm telling you right now, God wants to reward you for coming out here tonight. I am serious as a heart attack. This is not based upon your behavior. It doesn't have anything to do with how many great things you did this week. It has to do just basically because of who he is. And when he begins to reveal to you that type of a plan, it makes it a whole lot easier to lift up your hands and just say, God, that's kind of the thing I want right now. I want something from you, praise God. And by the way, you don't have to wait for some kind of a, you know, altar call or anything like that. If you feel your need in the middle of this service that God can do something for you, you can do just like what some of these are doing right now. You can just stand to your feet. You can lift those hands in faith, and you can say, God, this is it. This is what I want. This is what I need in the name of Jesus. And I'm going to tell you something right now. You're going to hear from God in the name of Jesus. I'm telling you the truth. You're going to hear from God in Jesus' name. What do you say? We just lift up our hands one more time and give him praise. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord in Jesus' name. Praise God. Now, you guys spoiled everything. You didn't spoil. You changed everything. That's what you did. And that's okay. I'm used to that, praise God. But I'm going to talk to you tonight, and I believe that the Lord is going to show you some things when it comes to his scripture, which I think is very, very important, praise God. Amen. I want you to stand for the reading of the word, if you're not physically impaired or if it's hard for you, whatever. But I think as a sign of unity, I want to just read a verse of scripture to you and just kind of set the platform there in Jesus' name, praise God. Carlos, I'm excited. If I had my way, I just wouldn't preach. We'd just get back there and we'd get the baptism. I'm serious. But that's not how it works. God says there's something I want you to deliver to the rest of them. And so you'll have patience and we'll get to you afterwards. But I am excited for you, excited in Jesus' name. Turn to the second chapter of the book of John, the Gospel of John, the last gospel that was written. I don't know if you knew that or not. I look at these young people right here, and I don't know if you guys knew of that, but John, the guy who wrote this gospel, he was very young when he was following Jesus around, just a teenager. He was not very old because he was probably in his 80s, maybe even 90s when he wrote this gospel, and it was the last gospel that was written, and he wanted to let some people know some things. And so I want to encourage you, live for God. I mean it. Don't let somebody come up to you and say, hey, you're a young man, you can't do this yet. That's not how it works in the kingdom of God. If you got faith, praise God, God can do some things for you right now in Jesus' name. In fact, the Bible teaches us that now faith is the substance of things hoped for. And I sense a little bit of faith over here. Little apprehension, too. You're probably saying, hey, these guys get like this all the time. No, we actually get worse than this. You're in one of our calm nights, okay? Just want to let you know, just so that you can understand. But I felt faith over here when we prayed before, and that's good. It takes faith to receive God's word. Amen. Just get into the practice of doing that. Praise God. The rest of these people know me, so I can mess with them. I got to qualify myself to you guys, okay? Amen. Did you bring these guys with you? Did you? Are you sure? They brought you, okay? You're following this guy? Oh. We need to, somebody lay hands on you. No, he's a good guy. I appreciate Chris. He used to come to this church on a regular basis, and he used to worship God. He used to praise him and give him the glory and that type of thing. I think he's ready to return to that type of a format now, aren't you? I sense that in Jesus' name. That's good. Let's get to John. Gospel of John, chapter number 2. The Bible says in verse number 1, I'm going to read like 5 verses there, so it won't be that long. Chapter 2 and verse 1. The Bible says, "In the third day there was a marriage in Cana," it says, "of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there." Scripture says, "And both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage." Goes on to say, "And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, They have no wine." Look at somebody and say, they have no wine. look at somebody else and say, they don't have any. Yeah, yeah. Well, the response, Jesus' response, it said, saith unto her, woman, what have I to do with thee? Whoa, that's kind of different, isn't it? She's probably expecting a little different response, but nevertheless, that's the one she got. What do I have to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. The Bible says in verse number 5, this is what I want you to see. The Bible says that his mother saith unto the servants, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. That's what I want, and I don't title a whole lot of messages, but tonight that's what I'm going to do. In honor of you, Carlos, of your baptism, I want to title this, whatsoever he saith unto you. Now there's an important key right there, an important key. Whatsoever he saith unto you, do it in Jesus' name. What do you say we ask the Lord to help us with that little bit of information? What do you say? Why don't you pray? I'll pray. You pray the way you feel like you want to pray. And let's just ask the Lord to help us in Jesus' name. Father, in the name of Jesus, I know that your word is anointed. I know that it is greatly anointed, Lord God, and it's forever settled in heaven. And Lord God, I know that there's people in this room right now that are settling it in their own hearts. But Lord God, I would pray that the meat of this subject, Lord God, would get a hold of each and every one of us. That Lord God, when you tell us to do something, that we would be quick to response. I would even pray against that skepticism and that spirit that would say, I'm going to just wait for a while. And I would pray that there would be people here tonight that would be ready to respond to what you say to them in the name of Jesus. And Lord God, I give you the praise, I give you the glory, all of the credit, Lord God, because your word, Lord God, is eternal. Your word, Lord Jesus, is going to last forever, Lord God. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but your word will endure forever, and I give you praise for your word. Would you join me in just thanking the Lord for his word? Praise God, praise God. And you may be seated. I'm not going to guarantee it, but I'm going to try not to be real long tonight. I try to do that on Sunday nights. The Word of God doesn't have to be lengthy for it to be effective. But I do want to get across what God wants me to get across. And there's three groups of scripture that I'm going to go to. This is one of them, praise God. I feel like this is an important point. I was telling the church this morning, I wasn't raised in a church like this. I didn't come to the Lord until I was, probably 22 years of age. Prior to that, I was, you don't want to know, and that's okay. But the bottom line is I began to search for God, and I searched for him in a lot of different places. I'm not trying to write a country song now, but I'm just telling you that I did. I searched for him in a lot of different places. And finally, I for some reason, I don't know who instilled it in me. I have absolutely no idea. My parents, they were good people, but they just weren't Bible people. The only Bible that I ever had when I was at home was my mom and dad in their 25th anniversary. They got this big, huge, I mean, two-person to bring it to the table type of Bible. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah, I mean, this thing was huge. And, I mean, it required two people to carry it and put it on the coffee table. And there it stayed for years because nobody had the strength to get it off of there, you know? And it was, and my knowledge of it was, you know, in the fall when you got these leaves that you wanted to get pressed. Yeah, I know we don't have a lot of that out here, but back in Iowa where I came from, they had that. And so we would get leaves, and one of the customs that we had was literally just to put those leaves inside that Bible because it had these waxed pages, had pictures. And so you could take two of them, and you could put a leaf in there, and it would press it just perfectly. Put a book on top of it just for good measure, and man, in a couple of weeks, you'd have yourself a pressed leaf. Isn't that great? That was the extent of my Bible knowledge. I never read it much. I never had, you know, I never felt like I had a need to. I knew there was a Bible, but I just, you know, it just never really interested me. But all of a sudden in my life, and the brother mentioned tonight, and by the way, there are no accidents in the kingdom of God. It's not an accident that you're here tonight. Come on, there's incidences in the kingdom of God. I told the church this morning there's crossroads that we come to, and God will still, he never takes away your decision ability. He won't do that. Even in lively services like this, you got to make up your mind to lift your hands. Even in lively services like this, you have to determine, I'm going to lift him up. I don't care what my neighbor thinks. See, that God will not take that right away from you, praise God. But he gives you the privilege and he gives you the choice, you know, to do that. And when you begin to do that, you begin to see the freedom and understand the freedom that you have in Jesus Christ. But for some reason, folks, for some reason, at one point in my life, I began to read the Bible. And I didn't even know where to begin, didn't have any idea, like a lot of you, you know. I didn't know what was going on, but I would just begin to read the Bible. And I just remember this. I was going through some troublesome times in my life, and some things weren't working out for me. But I can remember the comfort that I felt with reading the Word of God. There was just something about it that just began to put a peace in my life. I'm not making this up, by the way. I didn't read this in a book. There's no movie out on this, I don't think, yet. But I'm just telling you what happened to me. That's why I'm convinced of this, folks. You know, you can tell me all the stories you want, and I'll rejoice with you. But, man, once in a while, there's something's got to happen to me, praise God. That's not selfishness, folks. That's just the way it's got to be. Praise God. One of the things that God designed in his word is something called experience. He wants you and I to experience who he is. And I'll tell you, in a place like this, you can really do that. It's easy, and that's the way it's supposed to be. I know we can hear all the hard luck stories we want about what's going on in the world, and I'm not unsympathetic to that plight, but I'm telling you, there are still churches where you can walk in, where there's apostolic people that are filled with his spirit, praise God, and they're lifting up their hands, and you can feel the freedom of God in that, in the name of Jesus. And that is not an accident. Come on, folks. I'm telling you, that's the will of God. That's the will of God. Oh. Praise God. Praise God. And so again, you know, the word started to give me comfort, praise God. And I believe that's one of the first things we can feel from God. Because if you're like me, I'm going, God, he's not interested in somebody like me. He's probably got more, you know, he's got lots of people up there that can do things a lot better than me, and they're good and all that kind of stuff, so why would he waste his time with me? But I found out as I began to travel through the Bible a little bit that he loves everybody. Praise God. I mean that. You know, one of the scriptures that I can remember reading and kind of sent a puzzlement through me was, he so loved the world. So loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Now, I didn't understand all that was said there, but it messed with me. I thought, the whole world? God loves everybody? Well, that's true. And again, that's one of the leading causes of why God draws us into places like this. It's not our behavior. It's not what we do good. Because the scripture, you know, tells us that our righteousness is like filthy rags. I know that's kind of tough to swallow, but it's the truth. You can go to your best A game, and I'm going to tell you something, you're going to mess up. But boy, when it comes to God, he's perfect. And so you must understand, the thing that he's looking for, praise God, is he's just looking for somebody who will listen to him, and then, like I told you before, do what he tells you to do. Amen. Carlos, I hope you don't mind me using you for a little bit of an example. He came to me a couple of weeks ago, and he was talking about baptism, and that's what we're going to do after the service tonight, baptize him in the name of Jesus for the remission of sins. That's what the scripture teaches us to do, and so we're going to do that. But he came to me, and that was a good question. He said, well, when do you know you're ready? When do you know you're ready? Well, I said, well, you score 100 points in one game. You hit at least 3 home runs, right? Yeah. Nobody gets on base. You pitch a perfect game, right? No, that's not what I told him. I thought about it for just a second, and I thought, yeah, that's a good question. When am I ready? Well, I'll tell you something. One of the ways that you can begin to understand that you're ready is when, after God begins to deal with you about certain things, that you begin to commit yourself to it. It's not a fly-by thing. All of a sudden, you begin to take him seriously. Yeah. And I know sometimes we have a hard time with that because there's so much of it that we don't understand right away. But if you just do and begin to take some of the things that he tells you and become serious with it, I believe then you're ready for a step up. And it's been obvious in Carlos's life that that's taken place, that he's listening to God. He's seeing the things of God. And so I said, yeah, I think you're ready. And he came to me the other day and said, man, what do you think? I said, let's do it, praise God. And so you're here tonight, and you're wondering what God is dealing with you about. Well, he'll deal with you out of this word. Sometimes if you've been a pastor as long as I have, and I haven't been a pastor that long. I think I've been in the ministry. I was a youth pastor for 3 years. I was telling the discipleship class. I was an associate pastor for 3 years, and then I've been here for going on 28 years. And that's not, I don't look that old, do I? You're looking at me, and you're saying, my goodness, you're only about 32 years of age, right? That would, nah. Yeah, don't answer that, okay? No, but I'm just saying, I haven't been this for very long. I'm still very, fairly, I consider new. And so I'm learning things all the time. But one of the things that God teaches me, and I think he'll teach you the same thing, is something called consistency. I tell people all the time that when God begins to deal with you, or let me put it this way, God has probably been dealing with you a whole lot longer than you realized. It's just that sometimes we have to come to a place where we recognize that he's dealing with us. And he isn't dealing with us with a shaking of a finger saying, boy, you're so bad. No, he's just, that's what he's doing. Come on, I want you to be a part of this. Well, once you begin to recognize that, I'm going to tell you right now, I believe, and this is no big secret, but it works. He'll become consistent in what he does. Amen. And it's because of who we are. You know, we all are, to a certain degree, we're bagged with holes in it. I mean, we can pour stuff in, and boy, and within seconds or in minutes or hours or weeks, it can all leak out. Anybody identify with that? But I'm here to tell you, praise God. You know, she was telling me about her son having the problems that he was having, and I said, I could have saved you thousands of dollars. She said, what do you mean? I said, all you had to do is go to the auto store and get a can of Stop Leak and have him drink it. You guys aren't ever going to ask me anything, are you? No, I can see that right now. Boy, don't ask the pastor, man. He's going to give you one of those. No, but, the bottom line is God began to consistently talk to me out of his word. And what was happening, God was building a relationship with me, and that's still going on. Almost 40 years later, it's still going on. And you must understand, that's the vast majority of how God speaks to me. That's why I try to read, listen to, be a part of God's word every day of my life. Because God will speak to you through his word. But, somebody says, well, that's great, that's fantastic. Well, the bottom line is it doesn't end there. Now what God needs from you and from me is he needs a response from it. Case in point, here we are. We're at a wedding. And somebody said, why was Jesus at the wedding? It's very simple. He was invited. I know that sounds old-fashioned, but the bottom line is sometimes you got to invite God into the situation. Sometimes we wait until things get so bad. I mean, we've got, all kinds of explosives around this, and then we call in God. Why don't we get used to calling in God way, way ahead of that? Come on, I feel like that's good advice for somebody here right now, that you can begin a relationship with him. You can begin to call him into your life. You can start this tonight. Come on, you don't have to go days and hours and months and years without talking to God. You can speak to God every day. You can speak to God every hour. He gives you the privilege to speak to him every minute. That's what he can do. And so Jesus was at the wedding, praise God. And they ran out of wine. A lot of people think, was Jesus promoting drunkenness? You must understand the custom of the time. Wine at this point in time was something they drank. It was a grape juice. The water over there wasn't real great. And so that's what they made out of the grapes. And in order for fermentation to happen, you got to add something. In my opinion, they weren't adding anything to this. This was just what was the customary thing for them to drink. Food for thought. I know some of you are going, where did he get that at? Well, I've been studying the Bible about a lot of this stuff. But the bottom line is he was there. And they ran out. And the mother, she had compassion. This has got to be a big embarrassment. And so she goes to Jesus and said, hey, they're out. And of course, the response, hey, what's that to me? My hour hasn't come yet, But she had enough faith in what was happening right then. And this is what I want to really help somebody understand tonight. Let that measure of faith. The Bible says he's given to every person the measure of faith. That means you've got enough to believe in God right now inside of you. And if you'll begin to stretch that a little bit, if you'll begin to just respond to the Word of God, even though you don't understand it, but you begin to respond to what God is saying to you by faith, I'm telling you something, you're going to find miracles. You're going to find healings. You're going to find deliverances. I'm telling you right now, God is no respecter of person. That's in the Bible. He doesn't love somebody greater than somebody else. He just makes his love available. And there are some people that have found that little secret out, and they're just loading up the back end of their truck right now. Come on, do you need the love of God? Just go ahead and scoop some up right now. Come on, he's not looking at your report card right now. He's not looking at how great you were this week. He's just saying, my love is available to you. Oh, yeah. And so his love is always available. It's there. It's 24/7. Amen. We don't have to pre-qualify. We don't have to fill out 10 or 15 different applications. All we have to do is begin to call upon the name of the Lord. And what is that name? Come on, the name of Jesus. The Bible says there's none other name under heaven given to you and I whereby we can be saved. I'm telling you, when you begin to call on the name of Jesus, something begins to happen. I'll tell you one thing that happens. Your faith will begin to grow. Your faith will begin to grow in him. Come on, in him. Oh. Your faith will begin to grow in him. And that's what it takes. Come on, Jesus was very plain to us when he said, you don't have to have very much of this stuff. Come on, wasn't it him that said if you had enough, if you had a grain of mustard seed? He said you could say to a lot of things. I'm talking about having the right faith in the right person. Amen. And that kind of faith is what told Mary to say something. She just went blindly, or not blindly, but she went to those servants and said, listen, I don't know what's going to happen here, but I'll tell you something. Whatever he tells you to do, do it in Jesus' name. And this is the thing, Carlos, that all of us have got to get back to, the simplicity of hearing and obeying. Hearing and obeying. There's too many of us that want to become inspectors. There's too many of us that want to become qualifiers of the Word of God. Listen to me, folks. It don't take a whole lot of faith to have God do something and then believe in it. Where the faith comes in is before it happens, praise God. And then say, you know, God, I read this in the Bible. It happened back then. I believe it'll happen now in the name of Jesus. That's what I told you about the baptism of the Holy Ghost. It happened in the book of Acts. It'll happen right now in Jesus' name. Oh, hallelujah. Praise God. Group of scriptures, two. These guys are thinking, don't you ever preach to that side of the room? I'll get over there. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Okay, go with me to the book of Matthew now. Gospel of Matthew. Words of Jesus again. And let's not forget the thought. Whatsoever he says, do it. You pair of Nikes. Yeah. Isn't that what it means? Nike means just do it? Yeah. Yeah. Gospel of Matthew is an interesting book. It has a lot, to be said about it. It talks about the lineage of Jesus, and then it talks about some of his early escapades. And then it comes into his ministry, which is a tremendous thing. I agree with what John said. He said if everything that Jesus did was written, he said the books or the world wouldn't be able to contain the books. I mean, what we're seeing here is really kind of just a little bit of an overview, and that's hard for us to understand. You know, Jesus was 24/7. He was doing things all the time. One of the things that Jesus was very proficient at was teaching. You know. I picture Jesus sometimes as being a preacher, and the reason I see that is because sometimes he had to get loud so people could hear him. But a lot of the vast majority of what I see Jesus is placing himself in a place where people were around him, and everybody could sit like what you're doing right now, and he just opened up and just let it come out. Well, the 5th and the 6th and the 7th chapters of the Gospel of Matthew are just that kind of a setting. I mean to tell you, folks, we call it the Sermon on the Mount. And Jesus just let it fly. I mean, within those three chapters, I've been working on those three chapters for 40 years. And I am as serious as a heart attack. I mean, those things are just tremendous. But what I want to do is take you to the seventh chapter. And I want to show you something here. The Bible says in verse 22, I'm in 7 and 22, Sister Carnahan, Matthew 7, 22. The Bible says, now this is Jesus saying these words. He said, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied or preached in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? Yeah, those sound like pretty good works to me. Well, the Bible says, again, like the response to Mary, you're not expecting that kind of a response. You're kind of expecting, yeah, you did good. But he responds differently, just like he did with Mary. And so what he says is, he says in verse 23, then will I profess unto them. Wow, strange. I never knew you. Who are you? Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Wow, they did some good works, but he doesn't want anything to do with them. Kind of a strange deal, isn't it? Well, let's read on. He explains it to us. In verse 24, here's what I want you to see, to go along with whatsoever he says, do. The Bible says, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them. There's that word again. There that is again. Somebody talked to me about the Bible, and some people say, well, you know, God has done everything. Well, yeah, he's provided everything. But there are some things that you have to do. There's not one time has God repented for me. Now, he showed me how to do it. He showed me the necessity of it. But God doesn't repent for me. That's something I have to do. And so you must understand, with that type of understanding and knowledge, that God a lot of times is going to present the word to you just like he did me. And what it's going to really depend on is your response to it. And here's what we need to be thinking of. Jesus said, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man or a wise person. I think that's a good thing. He said, which built his house upon a rock. And the Bible says the rain descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. Wow. And then the Bible says, like Jesus would so often do, he would give us contrasts. Black, white, you know, dark, light, you know, that kind of thing. Well, then he gives us the opposite effect here. He said, to everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not, shall he liken unto a foolish man. You can't get too much opposite ends of the pole there. Wise fool. I mean, really, that's it. And the Bible says, which built his house upon the sand. I was asking a group here this last week, where do you generally find sand? We find it right next to water. It's one of the lowest places on the earth. So a lot of times it's not just the substance, it's the location. A lot of times God will begin to show you where you can begin to live your life safely. And if you will abide in those, I'm going to call them restraints of God, you will begin to realize that you can still live a very peaceful life on this earth. Come on, folks, in our prayer room this afternoon, I felt led that the Lord led me to bring these two police officers into the midst. And I don't know what you're hearing on the news. I don't listen to it a whole lot anymore because a lot of times it's just distorted. But the bottom line is, I know there's a lot of junk going on out there, but it ain't going to happen here in this church without us at least trying. And we put those two in the midst of us. They're police officers, by the way. And we put them in the midst, and we laid hands on them, and we put the covering of Almighty God upon them in the name of Jesus. I'm telling you something, folks, you can do something about this. You can do something about this evil world that you're living in. I'm telling you something, but you gotta do something. Okay, thank you, Jesus. So scripture covering number two, whoever hears it, and that's a guarantee, by the way. Because Jesus said that this gospel would be preached into all the world. And right now, with media and all the stuff that we've got right now, that is a cinch. Everybody's hearing about this gospel message. Amen. I'm telling you, folks, there are no excuses left. God is, like I told you before, God doesn't make people do things. He just provides the ingredients in which you can in a lot of areas. Amen. And that's what it comes down to, praise God. You know, you take the born-again experience. The Bible says he that is born of the water and of the Spirit, that's what Carlos is going to do tonight. He's going to be born of the water. Now, I'm going to tell you something. That is something he has to do. He has to make up his mind to be baptized in Jesus' name. But I'm going to guarantee you, it's God that fills him with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. We don't do that. That is the thing that happens. And so what I'm telling you right now, I remember to illustrate this, Chris, about it's close to 10 years ago. You know, I'm getting up there a little bit, you know. You probably couldn't tell, could you? Yeah, but I no retirement. I'm going, God, what are we going to do here, you know? And I'm not one to wait until the last minute for some of these stuff, And so I went to the Lord. I went to God when I was, I think it was like 51 or something like that. And I said, God, you know, we don't, not much in the bank here. You know, we need to get moving on this. And God, you know what God told me? He said, start saving. He said, you can do that. And you know something, within a month, I'm telling you the truth right now, within a month, that's what I started doing. It wasn't a whole lot, but I started saving. And all of a sudden, some doors started to get opening. God sent us to a financial person, and just to make a long story short, we're not extremely wealthy right now, but we're a whole lot further ahead than we were 10 years ago. And you know what God told me? He told me, if you will do what I tell you, I will do what you can't do. See, a lot of times that's the door that has to come open first. Jesus said to the churches in Revelation, he said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And whosoever will open unto me, I'm not going to just stand there with that dumb look on my face. I'm going to come in and I'll have supper with them. See, but the door has to be open. And God gives you that challenge. And that's why I'm telling you, there are some things that God says you have to do. And it's like we just looked at this one group of scripture. He said, if you'll hear it and begin to do it, you're going to be able to stand against any and every storm that comes your way. I'm telling you, folks, that's what the scripture says. That's what the scripture says. But back to what Carlos is doing tonight. Turn with me to the book of Mark. Been keeping us in the Gospels. I think it's a good place to stay sometimes. And so the Gospel of Mark is another one of those unique Gospels in the way that Mark is like a second or third generation. He had to hear this from people. He wasn't there. He was an eyewitness. Now, Matthew was, and John was. They were eyewitnesses. They walked with Jesus. How would you like to have walked with Jesus? Wouldn't that have been cool? Wouldn't that have been neat to see him break that bread? And those thousands of people ate until their stomachs were bulging out. And he said, well, gather up the stuff that's remaining. Wouldn't that have been a cool place to be? I think it would have been too. And so two of these guys, they were there. They saw it, praise God. And so they can give us that type of a personal account. But Mark wasn't. Mark came lately. He had to hear this from the generation that passed. Amen. Same thing with Luke. And so he's got to do a lot of research. But what you find in the Gospel of Mark is that he just deals with the facts. That's why it just seems like it zips through things. He'll go from one thing, and then all of a sudden they're over here. And then all of a sudden devils are going out of over here. And then over he's feeding these. Well, it's because Mark is just really dealing with the facts. Well, let me deal with the facts here tonight. The Bible says, when Carlos came to me and he's asking me about baptism, I said, one of the things you need to keep in mind, praise God, is we need to do it according to what the Scripture says. Can somebody say amen? Isn't that what we're talking about here tonight? Is that he that hears and obeys? Well, listen to what the Word of God says in Mark 16 and verse number 14. Verse 14. 16 and 14. Mark. The Bible says afterward, the Bible says he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat and upbraided them. That didn't mean he bawled them out. He just kind of reminded them of some things that they were kind of letting slip. See, these guys had seen a lot of things. They were there that day when that stone rolled away and Lazarus, who had been dead 4 days, came walking out of there. They knew the capabilities of Jesus Christ. And the Bible says he upbraided them with their unbeliefs and their hardnesses of heart. And I'm going to tell you right now, when God and I got on solid footing, and it took a little while, that's what God began to start dealing with me about. Why aren't you doing what the Scripture says? And he didn't do it in a snide, you know, get in my face type of way. He just did it very kindly. But he asked the question, does it not say that in the Word? Did I not say that? I'll tell you, this morning I was telling the church, Chris, that scripture, you must be born again. Oh, I'll never forget when God showed me that. And I realized something. I realized, because I had a kind of a chip on my shoulder about churches at that time. But I realized something for the first time, I think. Jesus said that. Jesus said those words. I better check it out. I better find out what he's got to say about it. And that began me on a journey, praise God, that helped me to realize that there were specific things that God told me that I could do if I wanted to. Amen. And the scripture tells us that that's what he did. He upbraided them. He said, come on, don't let that linger. The only bad thing about unbelief, folks, because we're all going to deal with it, is if you let it live, if you let it stay in your home, if you let it stay in your mind. Don't do that. Rinse it out with the Word of God. Come to services like this. Let God begin to build your faith in a way, praise God, that will extinguish that unbelief. Can you say amen? Amen. Well, the Bible says, and because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. And then the Bible says in verse 15, notice this. And he said unto them, and this is what I say to you, Carlos. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Now, most of you are got church background, so you understand what the gospel is. It's the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Can you say amen? Amen. Come on, I hope you still believe that. That's the good news. And you and I didn't do that. We didn't die for the sins of the world. Jesus had to do that. But we need to respond to that with an obedience. And that's why Jesus put this next line in there. He said, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Now, I didn't say that. The United Pentecostal Church International doesn't have a corner on that market. That was in this Bible a long time before this organization got formed. See, this is the Word of God. And I'm not just picking on this. I'm just using this as an example because we have a friend tonight that's going to be baptized in Jesus' name. And I want the rest of you to understand that he's doing this not because his mom thought it was a good idea. He's not doing this because the pastor really urged him to do it. I'm believing he's doing this because he saw it in the scriptures and he's becoming obedient to what Jesus said. Come on, what did the mother of Jesus say? Whatsoever he saith unto you. Come on, shout it at me. Come on, somebody shout it at me. Come on, somebody else shout it at me. Come on, I wish the world would get into that kind of a frame of mind. Because I know that God is dealing with people. I know that most of you have read your Bibles, and you might have come across some things that might have been a little bit leery. But I'm here to tell you, folks, if you'd get that faith, that measure of faith that he's given you, to begin to be operational in him, and you'd start having faith towards him, and not just in yourself, not just in any church, but having faith in this Bible. Because the Bible says faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. I'm telling you, they work hand in hand. And when you begin to obey the Scripture, I'm telling you, there's things that will begin to happen. It's just that plain. It's just that easy. Amen. Amen. And so I don't have some score to even up here. I'm not mad at anybody. I'm just simply the mailman tonight. And I thought what I would do is use the opportunity as an eyewitness tonight, because I hope the rest of you will stay. I don't know if you've ever experienced somebody getting baptized in full immersion. Man, come back. It's a neat thing. There's something that happens by you seeing that happen, yourself. There's a witness that goes forth. So I hope you will stay, praise God. But I also hope that there will be some of you that will contemplate what God is talking to you about. Because God takes and always has taken his word very serious. Now, just because you don't know it doesn't mean that you couldn't. And so this is the opportunity that you and I have, praise God, is that we can become Bible believers. And that doesn't mean that we rewrite the scripture. What it means is that we just listen to what God is speaking to us, and we get into the habit of doing whatever he says. That's what God wants to do in Jesus' name. Because he said, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. I didn't say that. He did. And then he said, these signs will follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils. God gives us authority over the demonic world. But listen to me, don't get the cart before the horse. You have to be brought under authority before you can exercise it. And you show that you are brought under authority by being obedient to God's word. It's just that plain, and it's just that simple. That's what God wants to begin to do. And then the Bible says, they shall speak, Carlos, they shall speak with new tongues. That's what I want to assure you about. That's the Holy Ghost. Just let it flow out of you. In Jesus' name. The Bible talks about the fact that they shall take up serpents, which is, again, a reference to the demonic kingdom. And the Bible says, if they shall drink any deadly thing, it will not harm them or hurt them. And they shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Folks, Jesus said these signs would follow them that believe. And so you and I, maybe 2,000 years later, we can expect the same things to happen in Jesus' name. Would you stand with me tonight? Carlos, I would like you to come, if you would, please. I'm going to send you in the back here in just a second. But I want us to pray for you. This is a serious thing that this young man is doing, and I commend him for it. I commend him. Praise God. I absolutely expect these things to happen. People start coming to church, listening to the Word of God, and want to do what God says. Hey, it's going to happen in Jesus' name. But I believe that God's got something special for you, too, in Jesus' name. Jerry, I want you to come, and I want you to just lay your hands on him right now. And the rest of you, if you would, just go ahead and extend your hands towards Carlos right now. And begin to just pray right now in Jesus' name. Father, in the name of Jesus, this is a tremendous step that he is taking. I do, Lord God. I expect, praise God, that that river of living water will flow out of him. This you spake of the Spirit in Jesus' name. That's it. That's it. That's it. Oh, hallelujah. That's it right there. That's it. Just let it come out, Carlos. Just let it come out. It's right there. Yeah. Yeah. That's it. You don't have to be afraid of that. That's the Holy Ghost. That's something inside of you that God put in you. In the name of Jesus. That's it. That's it. Oh, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Oh, what a beautiful thing. Come on, that's right. That's God. No prodding. I don't have to shake anything into you. That's God. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Now let me go. You go ahead and put your hands down. That's the same thing you felt the other night when you were praying, wasn't it? See, consistent. Yes, even stronger. And it'll get stronger. Now let me give you some advice. Would you mind if I gave you some advice? We don't know each other that well, but I think you could help. Try praying without gum in your mouth. I'm just telling you. That can become a distractant. And it just did with you. You were right there. I mean, it's coming out of you. And then all of a sudden that stupid gum got in the way, didn't it? There, I know, but there's going to come a day when you're not going to be nervous about this, that this is just going to flow. You realize that Jesus, when he referred to the Spirit, he said, if you believe on me as the Scripture saith, out of your bellies or innermost being would flow rivers of living water. That's what's fixing to happen to you in Jesus' name. Brother, why don't you take him back there and get him ready? Get him the big robe, okay? Praise God. Praise God. He's going to go back there and get ready. In just a few minutes, we're going to have a baptism. I do hope that you guys will stay in Jesus' name. Isn't it been nice having our visitors? Isn't it? Appreciate you guys. Hope you'll come back. Praise God. Praise God. But what we're going to do is we're going to just kind of unhook the plow here, and then we're going to go into the back. We got a baptismal set up in the back, and you can get real close, praise God. In fact, if you want to, you can even get wet. I'm not talking about SeaWorld, but I'm just saying you can get right that close. And we're going to have a baptism in Jesus' name. So please stick around. Praise God. Stick around.